So let's have a detailed look into these critical components. So power modules, as you saw, form the main power board of your inverter, and typically they are implemented either with MOSFETs, which are essentially field effect transistors, or also IGBTs, which are insulated gate bipolar transistors. And both these switches have their own characteristics, have their own area of operation. And as we see in this graph, depending on the power and the frequency that your inverter operates in, you'll have to select either the MOSFET or the IGBT. So if you have to operate at a very high frequency, in excess of say 20 kilohertz or something, a MOSFET becomes your main choice, because the IGBT has a very poor performance at high frequencies. And likewise, if you can keep your switching frequency much lesser, and you need a much higher power, in excess of 50 kilowatt, then IGBT is a very safe choice, because it is well capable to operate at high power levels with much reduced conduction losses, and this makes them very suitable for such applications. And in this figure you can see an example of an IGBT power module. So such power modules are well capable to take hundreds of amperes of current, and likewise hundreds of voltages also. And for MOSFETs, we saw that they can be operated at much higher frequencies, and this makes them a very good choice for EVs, because fast control is often a key requirement in an electric vehicle. So you'll see MOSFETs getting implemented in EVs quite often. Also, in traction inverter, the configurations of the power modules are highly flexible. So you may put the switches in parallel, or you might use a discrete switch or a power module. So typically, companies, based on the requirements and of the powers and the voltage, will try to select the most optimum configuration for your application. Yeah, to get into little more details, so we can see a power module like an IGBT, although ideally speaking it's a switch which can have only either zero or one output, either it's in off state or it's in on state. However, there are some switching transients that are involved in such power modules, and normally they are neglected. But for an EV, these switching transients that we are seeing here can play a very significant role, and it is these transients that also produce a lot of losses in your inverter, and they are also going to affect your overall performance. So in the figure we see it shows a off to on transition. So we can see that the current from zero is going from zero value to a certain value, and we see that it is not instantaneous. It takes time for the current to rise to its full rated value. And similarly, the voltage, which was VCE earlier, will go to zero when the switch turns on. However, again, this is not instantaneous, and there is a certain fall time associated with that, and it is these transients that is going to cause switching losses in your system. And every designer of a traction inverter needs to be careful in in handling these switching transients. So moving to our next subsystem, we saw that which is the control board. So we just saw the main component of the power board. Now let's move to the control board. So modern AVs will invariably employ a control system to control the power board. And nowadays, a digital signal processor is often employed for such control systems. And these powerful either 16 or 32 bit processors incorporate all the essential features or circuits that are required by the inverter. And so this can be quite a number of features. But the key features are listed here. So we saw that PWM is the key component of that because you have to drive the switches. So your processor needs to have the PWM channels to feed to your inverter. Similarly, we saw that it has to do some lot of digital processing. So all the analog signals needs to be converted into digital signals. So you have A to D converters. Then you have some communication interfaces for an inverter to interact with the other components in the vehicle. So CAN is the most commonly employed communication protocol. Then it also needs to have a memory to store your control logic. So all these processors come with a internal and an external memory. And apart from that, you have some timers, some serial ports to take care of your control systems. And lastly, there is also an encoder interface which is required for speed sensing of the motor. So typically, the speed sensor of the motor, as we saw, needs to provide data to your control board. And so it is going to do that through this encoder interface. Now, every control board shall have a control algorithm deployed in it. And this is required for the functioning of the power board. And there are a lot of control techniques. There's a lot of research that goes on in this area. But the vector control or the field oriented control is the one of the most successful control systems that is often employed even in EVs for a number of years now. And the key benefits is that it offers a very fast control of your motor. Because ultimately the inverter is going to drive your motor. It's comparatively simpler if we compare to some other advanced techniques, and it will give you a very smooth torque at the output of the motor. Yeah, and it's going to give you a good speed regulation also, because ultimately the speed of the motor is controlled. So the control algorithm is responsible for fast speed regulation, and that are important for EVs. And yeah, as I said, so it needs to provide a very smooth torque to the motor. So reduced torque fluctuations are again a very key criteria for any control algorithm. And also, the quadrant in which your inverter shall operate or the motor shall operate will again be determined by your control algorithm. So it is going to take these decisions based on the data it receives from the sensors. So when a braking is required, the control algorithm will operate your mode in the regenerative braking mode. So that's how the control algorithm plays a role for an EV. Coming to another critical component called as the gate driver. So we saw that the PWM needs to be fed to the switches, the six switches. So the control card will generate PWM and it will feed to your power board. However, again, you cannot directly feed a low power signal from the controller IC and directly feed to your switches. So a gate driver acts as a perfect interface for that. So it's essentially a power amplifier, which is going to convert your low power input from your control board, and it is going to convert it into an appropriate high current gate drive to a power module that we saw. And so this can be again either a MOSFET or IGBT that we saw. And so your gate driver is going to play a significant role in switching the power modules efficiently according to the commanded PWM. And when I say switching, we saw why it's so critical for the IGBT waveforms. So we saw that the switching transients are responsible for the losses in the inverter. So your gate driver is going to help you there to minimize those switching transients and switch your modules efficiently as possible. So in the absence of a gate driver, you'll have a very poor switching, or in most cases, you might not even able to switch the power module. And yeah, also, so we saw that the vehicle requirements are also continuously increasing. So the performance and the design of the gear driver circuitry is also becoming more critical, because the gear driver is going to control your switching transients, and there are also a lot of certain parameters that needs also efficient control. So as shown in the figure, so the gate driver control is going to take care of your MOSFET switching parameters to drive it in its most efficient zone. So what are the key features that we can expect from a gate driver? So firstly, it should have enough capability to quickly charge your gate capacitor that we saw here, for example. So CGS is the gate capacitor, for example. So your gate driver needs to quickly charge this gate capacitor with a high enough gate current. So it shall have a good current drive capability. Secondly, timing. So it should introduce minimum delays, minimum propagation delays between the input PWM and the output gate pulses. So both the input PWM and the output should be in phase. There cannot be delays in between them. Although they differ in voltage levels, you cannot have a propagation delay between the input and the output. Otherwise, your commanded PWM is violated. So timing is a very critical feature. Then it also should have some safety features, such as a dead band, where it will prevent from both the switches getting turned on accidentally, because in this case you have a short circuit. So dead band is a key feature. Then you have some overcurrent protection to turn off your switches whenever there is a thermal issue in the system. So all these are key basic features of the gate driver which it has to bring to the inverter. In addition to this, we have some more components in the inverter, and as I said earlier, so there's a for example, a motor encoder where that is going to sense your speed of the motor, and the speed data will be fed to your control card. So the encoder interface is a very critical component again, because without the speed data, your control algorithm cannot work. So it's very critical to have this interface and inform the processor about the speed of the motor. Then the DC link capacitor that we saw, so it's going to provide a very steady DC voltage, because there is going to be a lot of high frequency current ripple in our inverter. So the DC link capacitor helps to absorb that. Again, in the absence of that, you're going to have a lot of inefficiency and instability in the inverter. Yeah, the heat sink and the cooling system, as you saw, again, it's critical to absorb the losses in the power modules. And for high power inverters, this becomes more and more critical requirement. Also, for sensing, you need to have a current sensor to sense the currents in the AC link. So we saw that the inverter output will be three AC phases that will connect to the motor. So your control algorithm needs this high frequency current sensing for the control algorithm to process. So it's again a very key component for that. Yeah. So finally, so we'll come to this a simple case study for selection of a traction inverter. And so a very basic application is considered here. For example, we see a three-wheeler, and if the objective of is to electrify this three-wheeler, the main question is the choice of the inverter that is going to feed your traction motor. So here I have some basic parameters listed. So again, these are meant to change based on the size of the vehicle, but as an example, the power requirements can range from 5 to 6 kilowatt for a traction motor, and in some peak power requirements it can go till 10 kilowatt also. So it's very important to understand that the inverter should be well capable to supply this power to the motor. So this becomes a very key requirement when the traction inverter is selected. Another thing is that so the motor will have some torque and speed requirements. So these will have to be converted into electrical quantities in terms of voltage and current, because the torque normally is controlled by the current, and the voltage, the speed is governed by the voltage. So these parameters also become a necessary input when you are selecting a traction inverter. Again, a motor typically will have a rated AC voltage that it operates on. It's important to know this, because this is the output of the inverter. So the inverter needs to produce 33 volt AC at its output in order to run the motor at its requirements. So using this nominal AC voltage and using some sine modulation, it's quite clear to understand that the DC voltage range for this will be a 48 volt system where there has to be some range for the working voltage, which can vary from say 36 to 60 volts. So normally we see 48 volt commonly used in such three-wheeler applications. So the inverter needs to support that kind of voltage. So once you know the voltage, you'll have to make a decision in selecting the power device. So we saw that you can have a MOSFET or an IGBT, and we saw that the MOSFET has a very fast control and ideally suitable for an EV, and an IGBT is quite well suited at high powers. So since we know that the power levels are much on a lesser side, we can go with a MOSFET here. Similarly, the inverter, when you select, should have a valid temperature range. Again, and this will depend on the vehicle drive cycle. So what kind of vehicle and what kind of grid ability it has, what kind of loading it has. So the inverter should be able to support this operation. And based on the drive cycle of the vehicle, it has to work in the ambient temperature range also. This may be a factor of geography also, where the vehicle is driven, but it's a key parameter while selecting a traction inverter. The next is, as I said, you have a peak power for motor and a torque, and so these requirements needs to be translated into the current. And so an inverter should have a enough peak current capability to support the motor in its functioning of its peak power. So typically, this peak current is much higher value than the continuous current, and because it has to be supported only for few seconds, while the continuous current will last for a large amount of time. So not only your continuous current requirements are to be satisfied by the inverter, it's critical that you satisfy the peak current requirements, because the motor is going to operate either in the continuous power mode or in the peak power mode. And and as we saw, the nominal AC voltage that it produces again needs to be compatible with the motor. So if there is a mismatch, the motor is not going to be driven in a most efficient manner. So the AC output voltage of the inverter needs to match with the requirements of the motor. So in this case, we can see it's clearly matching. And lastly, again, with respect to your vehicle requirements, your inverter should have a good enough efficiency, because poor efficiency is going to cause a lot of losses in your system, which will drain your battery. This can affect the range of the vehicle. So modern day inverters are quite capable to reach more than 90% efficiencies also. But again, this depend on how the selection of inverter. So if a less compatible inverter is selected, you're going to have a much lesser efficiency. So it's imperative that while selecting the inverter, in a very good efficiency zone, and above 85% is often the basic requirement. So this is a so very brief example that will allow you to select an inverter for an EV application. So it's worth noting that the type of the vehicle significantly affects this. So if it's a, for example, a bus application, all these numbers are going to change drastically. Similarly, if it's a two-wheeler application, you'll have still lesser powers compared to this we see here. So your type of the application will dominantly affect your choice of the inverter. So that was it for the inverter. And at the end, just to brief you about the job opportunities in this area. So in general, job opportunities will be present in any automotive company that is working in the e-mobility segment. So we saw that the inverter represents the most critical component for an EV. So any company that is looking to venture in the e-mobility segment will offer you a lot of opportunities if you have the knowledge of a traction inverter. Also, knowing how a traction inverter works will allow you to work in the more generic power electronics area, So we know that pororatronics is a much has a much wider scope, and so there are more converters in addition to the inverter that are required in the vehicle. So the learnings in the inverter can be applied there also. So that's how the knowledge of the inverter is going to help you. So it's is going to allow you to work in a more generic area in the powertronics. And typical job openings include a powertronics engineer, as I just said, which is a more generic field. And apart from that, we saw there's a control algorithm in the inverter. So the control software developer will play has a responsibility to develop this control algorithm. Then you there may be openings for PCB designer to design the control card, and also a lot of testing goes into these inverters. So a testing engineer will be responsible for testing the inverter at its all voltage and current levels. So that was a summary for the job opportunities that are possible in this area. So yeah, so that's it. I think with that slide, I conclude my webinar. Thank you.